begin with a moment of silence. Exception of three people, and maybe they might find their way here tomorrow morning. I know it's kind of dark out there. They may not want to have run that risk. So will the Mahan of any of those who are still yet to come be responsible for sharing these instructions with them so that they won't be completely at loss coming in early tomorrow morning? Everybody has their schedule. Just a couple of things you need to make a note of. Most of you probably already know, but still I simply wanted to make sure that we're all on the same page so that we can use this occasion to its maximum of potential. The opportunity to stand back from our day-to-day rat race life style and living is such a precious opportunity. We surely do not want to waste it or cause anyone else to not fully profit from the time that we have been able to set aside. Everyone likes this place?
Yes.
Okay. I want to thank the retreat committee for, as always, doing a tremendous job. A lot of work goes into this, and hopefully you will not squander all that hard work and make right and full use of this occasion. You see, you really need to be able to stand back from your life every now and then so that you can have an opportunity to bear down on your sadhana, to make a straight run at it without interruption. And that's what these kind of occasions are intended to provide you with, an opportunity to push yourself, to push yourself, giving you time to push yourself, because you don't have to stop and get up and get dressed and get ready to go to work. Here you have a unique opportunity to push yourself beyond the limitations that you otherwise encounter in your regular practices. Hmm? And it is about practice. I have shared with many of you on personal occasion, and all of you at some level during formal occasions, that you have to bring the right attitude to sadhana. And that right attitude most fundamentally is the acceptance of the fact that you have got to practice. Most individual problems in their sadhana is rooted in the wrong attitude towards sadhana in the first place. The presumption that you are an exception to practice. You have got to practice. You cannot read yourself into a state of self-realization. You cannot analyze yourself into a state of self-realization. You must practice. And you must accept the fact that you must practice. You're not going to be able to achieve the same thing that these great spiritual beings have been able to achieve without doing what they did. They practiced. Now, we admire, for instance, the profound sutras of the Buddha, and we aspire to be like a Buddha, or the exquisite poetry of a Hafiz or Mirba, and so forth and so on. But all of that was the byproduct of their sadhana, their practice. You can't attain that kind of prajna paramita of a Buddha if you don't practice. You must practice. You must accept personally that you have got to practice and no longer exempt yourself from it. Are you with me? Are you following my argument?
Yes.
It's just like when you know you're poor, you accept the fact you gotta work. It's that simple. Nobody's gonna take care of you, no pie's gonna fall from the sky. You have got to work. Hmm? It is this acceptance of the necessity for practice that makes practice possible. Hmm? Over the long haul. Otherwise, your practice is always going to be sporadic, up and down, because somewhere deep down inside, you are conflicted. You are not yet convicted that you, personally, have got to practice. You're not a dinkery. You're not going to be exempt from the practice that has characterized the sadhana of every great spiritual being. Hmm? So you might as well stop your whining and bitching about it, and just accept the fact you personally must practice. You are not an exception to the rule. What arrogance to think that you will be excused from practice. So you got to get the right attitude. You must somehow overcome your willingness to fail at sadhana. Many of you are perfectly willing to fail at it. And it's this willingness to fail that is really the source of your failure. It's not the path. Your sadhana don't say anything about the path. Your sadhana says something about you. Please make a note. It says something about your character, what kind of integrity you have. You follow me? Well, that kind of character flaw where you are willing to fail. In fact, you're looking for an excuse to quit. On your cooler tapes, you know, every 2 weeks somebody in here wants to quit. I've been thinking about quitting. Sure, because you are willing to fail. That's why you think about quitting all the time, because you're willing to fail. You must overcome your willingness to fail. And you must do the practice. And this practice is fundamentally very simple. Meditation is really fundamentally about something very simple. Be still and be quiet. Make a move. Be still and be quiet in your mind. Somewhere in Scripture it says, be still and what? Be still and know that the I am is God. But you must be still and you must be quiet. Not just with your mouth closed, quiet. And stop all of this inner chatter that characterizes your mental condition. You're constantly talking inside your head. Talk. You can't shut the fuck up and be quiet. And you must be still. And you must be quiet. That's the whole essence of what meditation is about. And as you are able to become more and more competent in that discipline, when all that talking dies down and all the other distractions that we are giving our attention to quiet down, then the you can feel your true self. It just emerges to the forefront. It is always lurking in the background. It is always there. So meditation is not something about you're doing something to become your true self in the ontological sense. Because you are always already your true self. You're simply not having the experience of it because you are distracted in your attention. So again, meditation is about learning how to pay attention. To pay attention. You can't read a book to learn how to pay attention. You can't, you can watch all of the videos and hear all of the tapes you want. And you will still lack the requisite control of attention that is required to bring about that state of quiet and stillness that enables you to feel your true self. And remember, I have said on past occasions that you're not who you think you are, nor are you who other people think you are. Make a note. Why are you perfectly willing to question whether you are who you think you are? You're perfectly willing to accept without any question that you are what other people tell you. You're a nice man. You're a good husband. You're a wonderful wife. You're a good son. All bullshit. You're neither who or what you think you are, nor are you who and what other people think you are. And if you are able to radically understand that, then automatically the spiritual search begins in you. And the spiritual search fundamentally is this search for the answer to who and what am I. That's the fundamental motive that drives sadhana. Sitting to meditate is about the pursuit of the answer to that question. That can be answered intellectually, can only be answered by an experience. So as you sit still and be quiet and stop all of that chatter and dialogue, because all you're doing is talking to yourself. That's all you do all day long, is talk to yourself. That's all. If you can be still and shut the fuck up, then the process begins for you. You are able then to really enter into the process of training your attention, training yourself how to pay attention, to move your attention, to liberate your attention, to free up your attention. And free up your attention from what? There are four fundamental objects of attention. Just four things that you have to address in meditation. The first is to withdraw your attention from the world, samsara. Because a lot of our attention is focused into samsara, the world. By closing our eyes and finding a quiet corner somewhere to sit, free from distractions, solitude, we can have some possibility of withdrawing our attention from samsara. And that's the first leg of the journey. The second object that tends to absorb our attention is the body itself. And our constant preoccupation with trying to figure out ways to plagiarize it. Indulging in all kinds of things, simply and expressly for the sake of plagiarizing this body. We absorb it. Some to a point of pathology, pathologically involved in the plagiarization of your body and the indulgence of your senses. It absorbs all your attention. That's all you think about. Eating, sleeping, sex, food, bodily comfort. That's all you think about. All day long. What I'm going to eat, when I'm asleep. So we must be able to withdraw our attention from our near pathological obsession with the plagiarization of the physical body. The next stage of meditation is about withdrawing our attention from our emotions. Because so much of our attention is absorbed in these, the drama of your emotions. Your emotional drama absorbs most of your attention. If it is not already involved in the other two parts, then you are absorbed in your emotional drama. Who's done your wrong and so forth and so on, you see? And then the fourth and final object that tends to absorb all our attention is, of course, your mind. your thinking. And it's wrong to even call it thinking, because what you're doing is not thinking. You're just talking. Random, meaningless babble. All day long. It's all over the place. Nothing like critical thinking is going on. It's just meaningless babble. And your attention must be withdrawn from that activity. Well, the withdrawal of attention from any of those objects is not possible unless you can be still. And start being quiet. That paves the way now to liberate your attention from samsara, from body, from emotions, and from your compulsive and incessant thinking, babbling, chattering. And to the degree that you are able to do that, to that same degree that all of that fades out, the experience of your true self fades. And as you are using your Simran, Bhajan, or Dhyan to deal with the withdrawal of your attention from these four fundamental objects that are absorbing it, as you are engaged in that process, the more you concentrate, the more you feel your true self. That's a sign that you're concentrating. The more you start feeling who you are, that feeling of who you are has been called many things by many different practitioners, but almost all of them include the component of ananda, bliss, joy, that it feels good being who you really are. It beats the hell out of being who you think you are and who other people think you are. You see? So, on this retreat that we are going to be on, that is the whole focus. You all have met each other before, right? You all know each other's names. So, you can afford to spend some time in solitude here. That's what this place is all about, isn't it? Giving one another space to practice. And remember, it's about practice, and more practice, and more practice. That's how you are able to train yourself to pay attention to your Simran and Bhajan as an alternative and a substitute for paying attention to the four objects. Are you following me? Mm-hmm. You can't withdraw your attention from those four objects unless you give and have some alternative objects to give your attention to. The secret of withdrawing attention is giving attention. Make a note. You can't withdraw attention and then give it. Doesn't work like that. The more you're able to give your attention to something other than the world, the more withdrawal of attention from the world occurs. So, does that make sense to you? But you, your practice must be informed by a radical understanding. So I wanted to take an opportunity to just remind you of what you already know. I'm not telling you anything that you don't know, haven't read or heard many times before. But we want to focus on that now. Mm-hmm. and follow the schedule as closely as you can. Do as much practice as you can, both sitting while walking, the laboring. So during those periods where you are free to do your moment to moment, you know, there's an ancient device that it existed for thousands of years just for that purpose. There's paths out here for walking and practicing. Your task, if you are to make a right and best use of this opportunity, is to practice your ass off while you're here. Push yourself beyond the limitation of your usual way of practicing. When you become tired, push, because that's a pattern in you. You see? It's a pattern in you. When you get tired, you quit. Push past that fatigue. What you want is on the other side of fatigue. Push. You follow me? You must break that old pattern. So the schedule here has been structured to challenge you at every level, body, mind, all of it. And you will get fatigued. The body will hurt something, right? Push. Do something different than you ever done before, which is push. If the mood strike you, you got all night long. You see? Nobody stopped you. Push. You get sleepy tomorrow. Cool. You know, take you an hour nap. That's all you need. It'll knock the inertia right out of you. Push. Practice. Practice. And more practice. Now, tomorrow we will not start off with any kind of group formal meditation. I decided against that this year because too many people sleeping, snoring, coughing, farting. I'm only kidding about the fart. But the rest of the story is true. But you all understand what I'm saying. We can't have that. So please take care of your formal meditation in your own room or any place else out here in this beautiful place that you care to practice at. Doesn't bother me. But Rataji, you will make sure that the gong is rung at 3 o'clock.
Yes.
There's a public address system somewhere here, Mukherjee showed me. You can just stand there at the mic and send out 3 signals. Okay. It goes to everybody's room. So you'll see Mukherjee, and you can test it out. So draft one guy to go to the room, draft one sister to go to her room, and make sure that the system works. I believe it does. I heard somebody saying testing, testing, yeah. testing. But that, but you, Bhagwanji?
Bhakti Maji.
Who was it? Bhakti Maji? No, it was her. Yeah. So, but just test it out. So at 3 o'clock, and that way we won't have to have Satrani in you walking around. Ring it. Just go there and ring it. Now, some of you may not practice at 3, you see. So hopefully you'll push yourself while you're here to be capable of starting your formal practice at 3, 3:30. And then follow the rest of the schedule. Everybody understand? There's a lot of Maya that has to be overcome as it relates to practice, practice, and more practice. that people have a lot of Maya about that. And the principal Maya is fear. That if I practice and practice and do more practice, something bad is going to happen to you. As if something bad is not already happening. I mean, for the life of me, I can't figure it out. You try not practicing and look at all this shit that is happening to you. What do you people got to lose? The fear of something. What is your fear of practice, practice, and more practice? Find that out. That you will be bored, that it'll hurt. What is your fear? And you must give up this fear and practice, and do more practice. Not just here, but carry that spirit away from here, back into our regular day-to-day life. Some people fear that if I practice, practice, and more practice, I'll lose my wife, my children. Well, you know, all of that. You got wife and children, or you will lose wife and children. That's common. That ain't got nothing to do with practice. It's common. Are you with me? Some of you avoided practice and then still lost your wife and children. So, that's Maya. Whenever you get serious about practicing, the ego will definitely create a lot of Maya about what's going to happen if you really practice. And that Maya usually takes the form of fear. Fear and the willingness to fail. Actual conscious willingness to fail. You set yourself up to fail. You do just enough to fail and be able to rationalize and convince yourself that you did your best. It's a game you play. Are you with me? You must become unwilling to fail at this task of experiencing who and what you are. You must be uncompromised with it, unwilling to fail. As long as you are willing to fail, you will always come up with some bullshit to rationalize your failure. Always. And please make a note, it's just bullshit. Now we will have a look at the schedule, and I'll say a few more things because I know you are anxious to get started. Says here, practice, practice, and more practice. That's it. So everybody know what we're about during this retreat. And a couple of things where everywhere on the schedule where it says ground level, change that to chapel. We'll be doing all of those things that are located on your schedule as being at the ground level, which would have been upstairs. We're going to be doing that in the chapel. That's the most important thing. Okay. So you either can just make a mental note or you can write it in, but that should be pretty easy to remember. Yeah. We're not going to be using the ground level of the lodge. We're going to be doing all of those things in the chapel. The chapel is air conditioned and adequate. Now, all the other locations remain the same. We will be doing December and the budget and so forth, so in this room, but we will be separate now. So all of this stuff you drag down, you need to drag back up to your room, because that's where you're going to do your formal practice. And believe me, I'm doing this for your sake, because some of you have a decent formal practice, and you don't need to be disturbed by somebody sitting here snoring and all of this other nonsense. Are you with me?
Yeah.
I don't want to jeopardize you, okay? They can snore in their own room, all right? So we will definitely set the room up in such a way that you have as much space between each other as possible. We will have sisters on one side, men on the other, or we have sisters up front, men back. We're going to see how we can do this here. So I want to do that first, because that's probably going to be the most commotion. So Bilal, you can hold your film for a moment here. Mm-hmm. Now we got plenty.
Journey we call life. And this is what I found out. Listen.
It's amazing how you love me so.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
Yes, you are.
can feel this void.
You can feel this void.
And I thank you for those that have tried.
Some have tried.
But when you see me now,
I'm here because
I'm standing here
because of
your love.
Just wanted to say a few more things so that we can start the day off right, and just remind you rascals that this is such a great opportunity for you, and that you go into the day full of commitment and full of determination to break through the limitations that have been impacting your sodomy, you see. This kind of opportunity is rare, comes once a year, and who knows if any and all of us will be here next year. You see, there are those who are with us last year not here, and don't have this opportunity. You're still alive. You still got a chance. You're here. You got a chance. But you got to really go at this thing here. You really got to go at this. You got to really bring your best energy to this thing. We talked already about the whole point being to train your attention, learning how to pay attention, learning how to withdraw your attention from those four basic objects that absorb our attention. So this morning, you know, you're going to have a couple of sessions for practicing. You know, really go at it, you see. Don't just do the time. Do it right. Make a note. Don't just do the time. Do it right. And by right, I mean really full of intention. So we have some time to practice today. Try to at least give everything you can to try to withdraw your attention from at least some sorrow. The most fundamental and basic object that tends to absorb our attention. You see, maybe later on this evening, then go to the body, and then tomorrow let's go with the other two. But I mean, really go and then really do it right. Do it right mean set aside all your worldly concerns. Set that aside. Because most of your attention is absorbed in your worldly concerns. About all of that kind of activity that make up your day-to-day thinking, which is essentially revolving around just some basic things. The pursuit of other people's praise, avoiding of other people's blame. I've talked to you about the eight concerns, and that's set all your concerns aside. Your concern about being right and making others wrong and so forth and so on. Set that aside and do your simran right. Instead of giving your attention to all of this stuff, give your attention to the five holy names. Just sit there, sit still, be quiet, and set aside all of your worldly concerns. And do your practice. But really go at that. You know, really go at that. Don't let that just become more philosophy for you. You see? Really try to do that. Try to do this right today. Your attention run out to some worldly concern, just bring it back. Don't get absorbed in all of that. You see? Don't worry about the world. The world is going to be just fine. Trust me. Your world is not going to fall apart if you take your attention off of it for the few hours that we're here, okay? So sit down with the intention of doing it right and not just doing time. Don't continue this imitation of meditation. There's no profit in that. There's no fulfillment in that. Nothing comes out of it. And so we got this wonderful, wonderful opportunity. So everybody, has been initiated and instructed, given the same set of tools, this beautiful place, and so what else could a devotee want? This is a perfect context for practice, so make full and right use of it, but don't play it at this time. Just don't do the time. Do it right. Attention, wonders, we bring it back. Wonders, we bring it back. Wonders, we bring it back. And the first place that you got to begin your battle is to withdraw your attention out of samsara. Withdraw your attention from your worldly concerns. That's your first obstacle. So concerned about your reputation. What is your reputation? Who gives a shit about your reputation? And all you're doing is sitting there absorbed in your thinking about how to maintain your reputation, how to maintain, what, it's insane. Set aside all worldly concern, and you must bring a resolve to do this right. To do this right. Otherwise, you will piss away this time. And more imitation, more imitation, more imitation. And imitation is not good enough. Now, any questions about anything? Because this is an occasion for that. You see, we set aside a little time to just make sure we are all on the same page here. And today you see you'll have an opportunity to practice budget. Many of you struggle with your budget. Well, here you have an opportunity to get past that struggling. You got time to go at it. You can use your moment-to-moment time and go sit and do you some extra budget, because the only way you're going to get good at budgeting is to do what?
Budget.
That's it. There's no book you're going to read, no tape you're going to watch. No bolt of lightning that's come out of the sky nowhere. The only way you're going to get better at budgeting is to do more budgeting. It's really that simple. And the only reason you're not good at it is because you haven't done enough of it. See, it's a real simple problem. So you're going to have an opportunity to do budget. A lot of time we approach budgeting with no respect for it, as if it's some kind of optional part of our sadhana, something that we can do, not do, depending on how we feel after we've done our simran. Well, this is a wrong understanding. Simran is a servant to budget. Simran is a preparation for budget. This is surip shub yoga. This is not mantra yoga, it's surip shub yoga. You have to understand that the mantra that you've been given is just one of thousands of mantras. Mantras vary from tradition to tradition, culture to culture. The Buddhists are repeating this mantra. The Hindus are repeating that mantra. The Christian mystics are repeating this mantra, so forth and so on. So there's mantras, there's mantras. Are you following my argument? They're a kind of preparation. A mantra is something that you can use as an alternative object for your attention, rather than sitting there talking to yourself. Instead of sitting there talking to yourself about all your worldly concern, because that's all you're really doing, you're constantly talking to yourself about what I got to do, what I got to not do, what I need to add to my life, what I need to separate from my life. You're constantly sitting there evaluating, judging, and so forth. All of that is revolving around your worldly concerns, you see. And so instead of talking about that, talk the mantra and be withdrawn from all of that. So that's the function of the five holy names, whether they're the five holy names that have been given to you at the time of your initiation, or whether it's the holy names that inform Buddhism or any other particular spiritual tradition. Are you following my argument? The ultimate mantra that is unstruck, unspoken, anahata, is these five holy shubs. Everybody hear that, regardless of culture. Makes no difference. The Buddhists may repeat Om Mani Padme Hum and get into concentration. And when they get enough concentration, they're going to hear the five shabdas. Everybody hear the shabd. The Christians sitting in their cave repeating Jesus Christ, have mercy on me, and bring their attention here, and they will catch the same shabbat. That's why these bells are rung in these churches, to symbolize the hearing of this inner bell sound. The shabbat is universal. It's a part of every practitioner who is successful in bringing their attention to the 10th door experience across all time, all cultures. Are you following me? So don't dismiss your budget as being something that is optional. You're not going to be transported into any higher realms of consciousness without being able to fix your attention on this show. That's not going to happen. And today, if you get a little concentration on your way to getting a little concentration, and you have a little this or a little that, don't get all caught up in that. That's Maya. You understand? That's Maya. Stay focused on your simmer. Stay focused on your simmer. Stay focused on your simmer. Don't get caught up in the Maya. You know, oh, I'm floating out of my body. No, you're not. Just stay on your simmer. Oh, I see Bubba. No, you ain't seen me. How you gonna see me inside? You can't even see me here. I mean, let's be realistic, okay? Just stay on your simmer. Stay on your simmer. Don't try to promote yourself into a higher state of awareness. Just stay here, okay? That's how you get this work done. Are you all following me? So this is a wonderful opportunity, you know. Don't piss it away because you might not be here next year. And for all you know, this may be your last retreat. We have seen an instance already, every one of us having, that last year was Siddharji last time. Last year was Atmanji last time. So who knows? Don't waste time just socializing. You know? We can do that when we get back home. You understand? This is not, we're not coming out here to create a context and an opportunity to socialize all night long. You follow me? There's nothing to socialize about. You're here to practice. You're not here to socialize. You're not here to have any cooler meetings at all weird hours of the night. You're here to practice. Are you following me? So don't get sidetracked here today. Because that will be easy. You follow me? That's your habits. You see, you can't walk past each other without grabbing and squeezing one another. That's nice, but that's not what we're here to do. Give your time, energy, and attention to practice now. You can squeeze and hug and kiss one another Sunday after 5 o'clock, okay? No kissing, hugging until after 5 o'clock. Are you with me? I don't mean to be a killjoy here, but you won't have this opportunity to practice. So take advantage of it. Anything else to say about it? How are we fixed for time? I can.
It's
2 minutes to 7. 2 minutes to 7. We got a lot of time. You might start practicing. You better talk. You know, better start talking, or you don't have to talk if you don't want to. I'm just so concerned that you don't waste this opportunity. That you really begin to practice rightly. So that you don't have to read about the enlightenment no more. So So you don't have to read the poetry of Hafez no more. So that you're not dependent on Rumi and Mirabai. No more. No more Bibles. No more Gita. No more Qurans. No more mountain of spiritual literature. No more chasing down information. You see? I believe Billie Holiday said it best, God bless the child that what?
Got his own.
You got to get your own. And here today, you got to figure out on your own how to get this done. You can't sit around and caucus about how I'm going to practice more. You got to figure this out for yourself. You see my point? That's what we're here for. You know, use these hours and minutes that we have here. Walk this ground, sit by that water, do whatever you have to do, but you need to find out, you see, how to elevate your practice. You need to find out. You need to find out what works for you. You see? Not what works for us, what works for you. You don't know what worked for us if you don't know what worked for you. Is that pretty clear? Find out what works for you. You got to find that out. You got to find out how you can do more and more and more practice. You got to figure that out. How much food to eat, how much sleep to take. I mean, you got to figure that out. You got to find your own motivation. That's your work. You got to find your own motivation. Are you with me? It's not other people's obligation to motivate you to do your practice. That's your own responsibility. Until you're able to find out your own motivation, you're going to just be panhandling all the time, expecting and demanding other people, you see? To motivate you to practice. So get into this thing. And above all, don't play with it anymore. You see? I can't emphasize it enough, beloved, that you got to get past this being content with your imitation of discipleship, your imitation of meditation. You got to get past that. You know, as black people, I mean, it's just something culturally about us that cause us very often to become content with imitation. You see? I mean, we get beautiful cars, beautiful clothes, and we imitate the rich, the middle class, but we ain't rich, we ain't middle class. And most often, we don't have a pot to piss in, but we look in the pot. Are you with me? And that's old slavery stuff working. You follow what I'm saying? That's overcompensatory behavior. You know what I mean? You can't bring that to the path. This ain't about, you know, we're not a club. You know, you're the spiritual club and you want to look all of that. You see, it's not about that. You need to really, really get down to this thing. Anything else to say about it? just so excited. Satya is here, huh? And she's been missing all of the fun, huh? So I have to put together a little welcoming kit for you tonight. Hmm? All right, good. Well, I must tell you that I'm just really so happy to see how you all have been able to do the time. That's a good sign, isn't it? Huh? How many made all of the practices, took advantage of all of the opportunities that we had here today? Didn't miss the practices. Put your hand down. I know you missed one. Right?
Huh?
The sessions upstairs, that don't count, I can't see you. Right? Practice in the forest, practice in your alleged practice in your room out of my eyesight, don't count, huh? But certainly any of those sessions that you were able to get in helps you much, okay? Because as you can begin to see the Zendo is beginning to fill up with a kind of energy down there. Hmm? Have you noticed that? You tend to do better down there than out on your own. I have observed when you emerge out of the samadhi field that we have collectively created, usually you turn back into a pumpkin out there walking along the path. You know what I mean? I mean, you fall right back into your old postures. I mean, you start blabbing at the mouth. And unfortunately, one of the things I observed that a lot of you just kind of pissed away your moment-to-moment time. You see my point? Which could have been time that could have been converted to more sitting practice. If you can't do moment-to-moment, then what you do at that sort of time is sit more. Hmm? Otherwise, you would tend to piss it away. Hmm? But that's okay. You didn't go get broke, huh? You got the basic stuff going. But I'm telling you that I am just really just delighted, just happy beyond all measure to see how well you all have been able to take advantage of what has been offered to you thus far. You can do better, so we want to end our day by addressing what you can do better, because you have tonight, you still got tonight, and you still got all day tomorrow up until 5 o'clock, so there's still time to correct yourself, and not leave here without leaving with an arm full of sadhana. You see my point? You want to take your armload of sadhana and skill out of this place with you. Hmm? The most important thing is to always keep in view what you're here to do. We have come here to practice. Right? When you lose that, then that's going to kind of set you up to start squandering some of this opportunity, you see, because you'll start doing all other kinds of things while you're here, other than what we're here to do. We're here to practice and what?
Practice.
And?
More practice.
And?
More practice.
There you go. We're not here to do anything else. Now, if your practice has already been perfected, okay, then you can take a dip in the pool. And, you know what I mean? I think there's some horseshoes you can throw back there. You see? But if your sadhana is not perfect, you cannot afford to be playing out here. Are you following?
Yes.
You're here to practice. Now, I know that a lot of times what the ideal is that after coming up out of the Zendo, you're challenged, you push. The body is really pushed, so forth and so on. And there's every urge and tendency to kind of relax as you walk up those steps. Damn, that's over with. Glad that's over with. That got me an hour to, you see, reboot, right? But the ideal is not to reboot. The ideal is to exhaust yourself, because when you exhaust the body, guess what else get exhausted? And the what? The three-letter word? Right. That's how you weaken the ego. Right? The body is its Achilles tendon. Right? Exhausted. That's the whole genius of effort. I don't know if Saratia shared with you all the esoteric dimensions of effort and all of that. We certainly have read in many cases where effort is basis for attracting grace, and that's very true. But it's even more profound than that, you see. Effort at the level of the body and mind weakens the ego. You understand? Sometimes you just be too tired to fight.
Right.
Right? You're just too tired to get out. Just, shit, go ahead, man, because you're too tired to argue. You're just too tired to pursue your point. You're just too tired. Or you got a headache. Oh, my head hurting, you know. You see, and, go ahead, take the keys, you know, whatever it is. So the purpose of this kind of straight ahead sadhana is to tire your body out, is to fatigue the body, is to start getting that mind where it's saying, oh God, not another session, you see. Right? That's the whole idea. And once you got the ego on the run, you run it over. See? You got the ego on the run. You want to bust through the fatigue. You want to wear yourself out. And meditation. You want to wear yourself out. Body, mind, everything. That's what it's all about. Sit so much that you just, you can't sit another 5 minutes. Yeah, that's exactly it. That's exactly where you want to go. That's exactly where you must go. But you see, if you get tired, and because you are still sympathetic with your body, mind, it being who you are, right, you're going to say, oh, I gotta let this body rest. And your ego now will reboot. Mm-hmm. And that's where you start messing up. You see? Are you following my argument?
Mm-hmm.
Now, some of you are booting back up your egos. And I'm trying to wear it out. So, you know, help me out here. All right? You're here to practice to the point of exhaustion. Now, another thing that weakens the ego is to deprive it of sleep. Sleep deprivation. Now, they use it in all kinds of situations. Certainly in interrogation, both military and civil, right? Katabaji, you know about this, right? Keep him up, right? Breaks that will, break that resistance. He'll tell you everything, right? Just deprive him of sleep long enough. The ego, you see, is weakened. And the same is the case with food, you see? Even talking less weakens the ego. All of these things, you see, talking less, eating less, sleeping less, and hours and hours of sitting, meditation. That's how you deal with your ego. You can't deal with your ego reading a book. You know what I mean? I'm going to read this book and deal with my ego. Who are you kidding? That's not going to be effective. Watch a couple of videos before I go to work to bring my ego in check. That's not effective. Are you following me? Sitting meditation, sitting out, meditating, and you know, whatever you're doing, always being up to and about this meditation. That's what exhausts this body, mind, and thus exhausts this. You must wear yourself out, literally. And that is what retreat is all about. That's why we come into a Zendo type situation. That's why in traditional Zen, and this is not a traditional Zendo, obviously. You know what I mean? This is a kind of Christian retreat center. You know what I mean? It's slash homes, blah, blah, blah. That's why it's set up the way it is. It's got air conditioning. It's got pop machines. It's got swimming pools, it got, you understand? Mm-hmm. It's there to keep the ego from collapsing. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? In a Zen, though, that's none of that. There's no cloak machine. There's no heat. So if you go in the winter, there's no heat. If you go in the summer, there's no air conditioning. If you go in the winter, you better have your 4 or 5 coats on, because that's it. There is no nice bedroom. There's your mat. You sleep here. You eat here. I mean, it's a very different thing, you see. Hence, it has been very effective in bringing people to a point where they are able to duplicate the Buddha's enlightenment. Buddhism is one of the few traditions that you can still see some authentic episodes of enlightenment, because they know how to really deal with the ego. If you ask the Zen master a question, he's not going to give you no straight answer. The shit is going to be so backward and upside down, you wish he hadn't answered you at all. You know what I mean? He's not going to indulge your intellect and none of that. You know what I mean? He ties you up in more nonsense until you nonsense yourself out. Give you a koan. Go play with this nonsense. And you play with it 3 or 4 years to nonsense yourself out. The intellect dies just... It kills itself. It's self-destruct. So they're brilliant in that respect. Now, of course, that tradition is not the only tradition. All of these traditions have something unique to offer us. And the ideal is that we should take advantage of whatever's on the planet, right, to help us out of our own dilemma. We have the ordinary human dilemma plus, 500 years of slavery and all of that, you know. So we got like a kind of double dose, you know what I mean, of misery going here. But in any case, I'm just wanting to share with you that in spite of anything else, you all are doing a good job. You see my point? You're getting close, so it's just about what you're going to do tonight, you know what I mean? Okay, maybe you pissed away a little time earlier today. That's all right, you know what I mean? I ain't mad at you. I still love you. You still got time to go back and get that. Are you with me? You see? You go back and get that. You see? You still got tonight to pull it off. You follow what I'm saying? To pull it off. You see? Maybe replace one of your hours of sleep with some sitting. You know what I mean? Go back down there and get you some sitting in for the hour that you pissed away. You follow what I'm saying? It's not too late. It's not too late. Or maybe tomorrow skip breakfast and go down and or go up in your room somewhere. You see, try to make up as best you can for whatever time you pissed away today. Okay? Because there's still time. You know, there's still time. So you got the body on the run now. You see my point? You got the body on the run. It's getting tired. Your back is starting to hurt. You know, your knees are beginning to buckle. Beautiful, love it, you know. So you got the ego on the run, and you're standing there like a big dog. You see my point? I mean, you know, you said, you see, you didn't talk about doing meditation. You did it today. Right? Normally you'll spend 6 hours talking about meditation. Well, today you actually did 6 hours of meditation. Give yourself a hand. What a fool! And so we are, you on the move now. So don't stop. That's what I'm telling you. Don't stop. Don't get complacent. You follow what I'm saying? Don't think you've done enough today. And let me get some rest. No. We didn't come here to rest. We came here to do what?
Practice.
And what?
Practice.
And what?
Practice.
That's what we came here to do. You wanted to get some rest, you go to a different kind of resort. We're not here to get no rest. We're not here to get a good night's sleep. You follow what I'm saying? We're here to practice. And you must keep this uppermost in your mind, you see? No matter where you're moving about here, and no matter who you're interacting with, see, because you're going to interact with each other. We can't avoid that. But you know that fundamentally you're not here to just slap each other on the back, you know what I mean, and compliment each other with what a swell job you're doing. You're here to practice. Even in the midst of one another, you're here to practice. Is that about right? Because that's the same challenge you're going to have when you leave here, is to practice in the midst of people. If you can practice in the midst of this crowd, man, shit. Right? Your side are going to go through the roof, right? Because you are attracted to these people. You are interested in these people. There's a natural impulse to gravitate toward them. And if you can transcend that, right, and practice, if you can give your attention to your practice and not to Bilal or not to Baradaji or not to Mukherjee, even though you know, just want to go there and just kiss them, you know what I mean? If you can resist that impulse, you see, then you can resist anybody out there in the public arena, can't you? And stay focused. That's why in Buddhism they say, if you see the Buddha on the way, you do what?
Kill him.
Now, you know, yeah, I know that's a metaphor, right? So I want y'all knocking the shit out of one another. You know, when your brother was knocking Dhamma Maja's teeth out. That's not what I'm advocating. But you understand the point?
Yes.
So that you can stay focused and purposed. You can't lose sight of your purpose for being here. You're here to take advantage of this extraordinary opportunity to enhance your practice, to refine the details of your practice, to strengthen your practice, you see. Now you've been given more reminders about Simran, what it is, Bhajan, what it is, Dion, what it is, so hopefully you know, you got a little bit more insight into all of that and how to use that, what it's all about. We talked a little bit already about the fundamental task that meditation addresses, which is training the attention. You got to learn how to pay attention. I've said that we can sum it all up by simply saying it's to learn how to be still and be quiet. So that you may withdraw your attention from the four objects that tend to absorb it to the point of keeping you endlessly distracted. So distracted that you can't even feel your true self. I mean, imagine with me for a moment a kind of condition where you are so distracted you can't even feel your body. You see, by example, do you follow me? That's a major distraction. So caught up in your internal dialogue, it's so caught up in your concerns, cares, just distracted. To the point that you're not even aware of your own presence, let alone other people. It is common in our collective experience to be so preoccupied with something that we'll walk right past your mama and don't even say, hi, mama. You see my point? You're that distracted. You see? So can you imagine a kind of distraction that is even more profound than that? A kind of distraction that is so profound you're not even aware of your own existence. You're not even aware of your own true self. And that is because all of your attention is being consumed in your samsara, your world, your personal world, you see, where you are up to all that kind of activity to make yourself happy, so forth and so on. And the only way that you can withdraw your attention from any of those four objects is you must first give your attention to some alternative. Are you with me? And that's what meditation is about, isn't it? About giving your attention to something else so that attention may be liberated from samsara, the body, your emotions, and your mind. Is that right? So when you give that attention, you're trying to give it all that attention, because the withdrawal is going to be proportional to the degree that you're able to give attention. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
If you just only can give, if you're sitting and you're doing your simmering and the experience is that, oh God, boy, I can hardly keep my attention in this process. You know what I mean? Out of an hour, maybe I'm able to keep my attention in the process for 60 seconds. Right? Well, for all the rest of the time, you're trapped in samsara. The liberation of attention from samsara and the other objects is proportional to the degree that you are able to give your attention to its alternative. Are you following? That's why the objective should be to strive with every fiber in your body to become absorbed in the Simran Bhajanadiya, whichever one that you're doing, to become single-mindedly, single-heartedly absorbed completely in that. Only this kind of single-minded absorption in the spiritual process guarantees complete liberation, moksha, salvation. But being able to pay attention to or absorb your attention in your simran, bhajan, or dhyan for about 60 seconds per hour. you do the math. You do the math. So tonight, you know, after you get you a few hours of rest, if that's what your part of your plan is, I mean, because it's your night, you see, you have total freedom of what kind of use you will make of it. But if your plan tonight is to get a couple hours of sleep and so forth and get up in the morning and so forth and so on, then remember, you see, when you start doing your simran, remember that, you know, that it's about becoming absorbed in that simran. And that absorption in your simran is made easier, you see, if you can just set aside all your concerns and cares about yourself. You can set down this burden of self-concern for a minute. Like you take your watch off and jewelry off and so forth and so on when you're about to sit. Well, if you can just take off all of this self-concern too, you give yourself a better chance. But it's very hard to maintain your self-concern and to do simran. You understand? that's pretty hard to pull off. You know what I mean? Actually, it's impossible to pull off, isn't it? Your simran automatically falls to the background, and the self-concern-based thinking is dominant. And in the background, every now and then, you could maybe hear one or two words of simran float by, but fundamentally, you know what I mean? I mean, simran just goes, shoom, like cars. you see. And that's a matter of making up your heart and mind. So, those were just a few of the things I wanted to share with you as you get ready to go into the night. And then, of course, tomorrow morning, we got the till 5 o'clock. You don't have as much moment-to-moment time tomorrow, if you noticed. It's not built into the schedule. I tried to give you as much of that advantage today. So, I thought on the last, I didn't want to take any chance. You know what I mean? Because if I give you 2.5 hours of time to practice moment to moment, you know, in a more comfortable posture, perhaps, or walking, or something, that you usually piss away 2/3 of it. And I thought that's too much time to let you piss away. You know what I mean? Give you a half an hour. That's enough to put in the ping ball machine. Keep the rest of the time for the practice. Any questions about anything that you would like some further comments about that will help you make better and better use of the remaining time that we have left here? This is an opportunity to do so. Yes, beloved.
When you do the stay, do the all night practice.
Mm-hmm.
How exactly do you schedule yourself like that? You sit for an hour and then do what?
That's one way to do it. I mean, you each individual pretty much know there are. Capacity for practice, their current level of capacity for practice. So let's say if you can do an hour, but you do an hour seven, that's 2 hours. You know, you may go and do some walking for the next 30 minutes or so, you see, just to knock off the fatigue. Then you come back after you have knocked off your fatigue, and then you repeat the same set. Right, then again, you knock off the fatigue, because the fatigue is going to come, obviously. And you're just knocking it off so that you can get more tired. That's all you're really doing. But the point is that you're trying to keep right at it. And so it depends on each individual. Some people, if they are not able to do that level of practice, that say they can do a half an hour, they may do a half an hour of simmering, a half an hour of budging, an hour of simmering. Rest hour, budging, rest hours. I mean, it's no real hard and fast rule. So you gotta find out what works for you. You see, that can't get prescribed. You know, I can give some general comments about it, but really, I mean, that's what you gotta find out. You gotta find out what works for you. You gotta find that out. You see, what pace is for you. I used to always say that. Everybody have their own inherent and intrinsic pace. You got to find your pace. A story is told of Maharaji being driven to some satsang somewhere in Delhi. I guess, I don't even know where it was, maybe Bombay, but where in India is not the point. The fact is that the story still is useful. He's being driven to some point for satsang in the traffic in India. Those parts in India I've traveled in are just horrendous. You know what I mean? There's no stop. I mean, it's pure chaos. And every kind of animal is on the road. You know what I mean? You got buffalo, cows. I mean, it's hard to imagine that that's normal for that particular culture. Well, anyway, so Maharaj is running late, maybe thousands of people are waiting for satsang, you know, and the driver is trying to get him there because that's his seva, you know what I mean? And he's trying to get Maharaji to the sangha, that's his seva, that's his job, and he's trying to do a good job. So he's driving a little fast and hitting brakes off, you know, and he could get stuck behind a water buffalo, you know what I mean? Now, you can imagine what's going on, because this water buffalo is just... he's getting really frustrated, you know what I mean? Maharaji can see that he's getting frustrated. Maharaji tell him, you know, brother, you know, calm down. Stop hollering at the buffalo. You know, he's hollering at the buffalo. Go faster! Why don't you go faster, buffalo? You see, I'm trying to get Maharaji to the buffalo, can't you? And Maharaji talking to the buffalo. He said, listen, he said, the buffalo knows at what pace for it to move. And that's the pace it moves at. You move at your pace. That's a bad analogy, but you get my point. You have your pace. Now, some people have to take things slower, not as a means of justifying and rationalizing doing it slow, but they need to do it slow. That's how they learn. That's how they comprehend. That's how they master things. Some people can do things fast and master it. They have to do it fast. It depends on each individual, but you have to find that out. And moreover, you have to already, first and foremost, have had to make up your mind that that's what you're going to do, you see. And that's, I presume, is what we've done. We've accepted the path. We've accepted sadhana, right? And this is what we decided, at least for now, is what we're going to do with our lives. So that was the hardest part. You know what I mean? The rest will, you know, if we just hang in there, we'll get it done, because we've done the most basic work. You follow me? We chose to be here. We're not here by default. You know what I mean? We're not here searching. We did that part. You know what I mean? So we're not searching anymore. We are finders of our way, for now. So we are trying to handle that business. So this is a good thing. So, beloved, use the night according to your own instinct. You know what I mean? But use it. Because once this night passes, we may not have another night with this kind of opportunity for a year. And who knows who will be missing in this room next year? Sadaji had no idea he wouldn't be here. He was looking forward to this. That's all he was talking about. Bhagwan, with the retreat coming, what are you going to do this time, Bhagwan? You see? I said, Sadaji, I got some good stuff for you. Man, I can't wait. Man, we should try to go on this retreat next week, Bhagwan. He's not here for a retreat that would have really excited him, pleased him. Sadaji would have loved this kind of retreat. You know?
Yeah.
Is that about right?
Yeah.
That's right. He's not here. And you may not be here. I may not be here. So don't squander. Anything else to say? I think we're going to observe the talk less principle. And just take a few minutes and just rejoice and relax in each other's good company. And Roger Vitter, you can play a couple of your secret weapon subjects back there that you have. And then we will get started with the night portion of our work.
It's been your mercy and it's been your grace that has kept me till this very day. I could have
You have the power.